Thank you for watching Urban TV. I am Jackie Achan. Tonight on Checkpoint, we host the MD, Managing Director of Uganda Development Bank, UDB, Ms. Patricia Ojangole. She has been at the helm of the bank for almost 10 years now. She is also the first Vice President of the Association of African Development Finance Institutions, and recently she won a global accolade for Sustainability Leader of the Year. We shall be talking to Ms. Patricia Ojangole about her journey into the banking sector and what it has taken for her, you know, to be at the top. But for now, let's start with getting to know you a little bit. Tell us about yourself, where you grew up, your childhood, where you got educated. We just want to get to know a little bit about you and your background.
Thank you, and thank you for inviting me. I am born in Palisa, and I grew up in Palisa, and I spent my childhood in Palisa with my grandparents initially, and I went to school initially in Palisa. My grandparents were teachers, and my grandfather was a headmaster in a school that attended primary, lower primary. I did not attend nursery school because my grandparents were primary one and primary two teachers. So because we were the children at home, we used to go with them to class. We played when we before, below school going age in class where they taught. So when I was around 4 years, I joined P1 when I was four, and that's how I progressed through primary school. When I reached primary seven, I came to Kampala, and I did my primary seven in a school in Kampala, and I went to secondary school in Toro Girls School. So I was in Toro Girls from senior one to senior six. And then from Toro Girls School, I went to Makerere University, where I did my Bachelor of Commerce degree, majored in accounting. So after finishing school, I joined Uganda Commercial Bank. Then we were with UCB for 1 year. And then after that 1 year, the bank was privatized. And then Stanbic took over some of the employees. And yes, I was taken over then by Stanbic Bank. So I started my banking career, I think, with a Stanbic, I would say, because I was in UCB just for about 1 year, and it was really the year of transitioning and acquisition of the bank by Stanbic Bank. I did my SCCA soon after that, and I got married also soon after school. So I'm married to Mr. Valentino Jangole, with whom we have four children. So it's been, since then, a life of career, family. So after SCCA, I did my executive MBA with ESAMI. And, of course, that was while I was still in Stanbic Bank before I joined UDB. And when I joined UDB in 2011 in the position of Chief Internal Auditor. After working for about 2-3 years, after getting into the role of CEO of UDB, I enrolled for a Master's of Philosophy in Development Finance. So because I had now kind of changed career from commercial banking and from the audit work that I was doing into now development finance and more of a strategic role, I thought it was important for me to understand, one, the practical work that I was doing, but then complement it with the theoretical aspects of what development finance is, what development banking is. So I also believe that if I was going to lead and guide the institution competently, I also needed to be technically capable and competent. And so be able to lead, you know, strategically, but also technically. So that is why I did look for a program that I thought would help me complement the experience that I was getting in terms of ensuring that I can guide or lead the institution in a right direction. Talking about studies again, when I finished the MPhil, I thought I would enroll for a PhD program, but to understand again really better what I'm doing and what our contribution is. Although the program that I'm studying, it on my own, but it helps me to again position the institution to do its job well. So I am doing a PhD in development finance, and what I am studying is structural transformation, productivity, growth, and financing constraints. So it's really meant to help me understand well where does productivity come from, which sectors, how can we then help those sectors to be developed so that they can maximize the productive capacity within those sectors as we seek to create more jobs, get more people employed, and not just any jobs, but quality jobs that can really change the economic status of people. Mm-hmm. So that has been my journey of school and education and work. Talking about adult life, I don't know what to say, but since then it's really been family, like I have mentioned. We're raising four children. They are aged between 12 and 22. I think our firstborn just made 22 a few months ago. 21. Yeah, between 12 and 21. And so it's really been family, work, and of course dealing with the responsibilities that everyone of us have in one way or another. So I think life has really been pretty much that.
Well, before even we dive into other questions, I was listening to you and I'm seeing that you've invested so much in your education. Yeah, I'm wondering how you can be able to manage that, because right now you are at the helm at the bank, you're doing a PhD, you have family. Where do you get the time? How do you even manage?
Yeah, I think it's about prioritizing. First, at work, the team that I work with is very, very good, very, very supportive. And I think that is the top most benefit or advantage of really having people that are technically good, that are professional, that you can depend on, that you can rely on. So I must say that the team that I work with, I think that they all got all those attributes. And so we are able to agree as a team and support each other as we work. So the team is very, very, very supportive. I talked about prioritizing. At home also, I have a very good support. My husband is also very supportive. The children are okay. I think also what helped is, our children are kind of spaced. So it's not that I had a baby every year or two babies in 1 year. So they have a spacing of 3 to 4 years. So you find that when you're raising children, it's like you have one baby at a time. So it helps you to focus on other things that you have to do, like advancing, you know, your career. So that has also helped. And then having the right social support at home. The people that you work with, even the support staff that you have in office, at home. We also lived with my grandmother for 21 years since we got married. So she also used to help us kind of take care of the home when both myself and my husband were also busy working. So I think pretty much that is what has helped, supported. But also I think it's really... You have to know how to use your time. There are so many things to do and there is so much that needs to be done. So, for example, when I was starting the MPhil, I knew that this is something new coming into my space. I have to create time for it. So I had to go through a deliberate process of looking at how I live my day, you know. What time do I wake up? What time do I get to office? What do I do, you know? What engagements do I have? What do I do after work? So I had to take some time and then make a deliberate decision and say, now I'm going to go to bed at this time, I wake up at this time, I reach office at this time, maybe I use the first 2 hours, you know, in the office to study maybe from 6 to 8 and then start work. So and then after work, if there is more time, then you can see what else you can do while handling everything else that you have to do. So you have to see how to use your time. We spend a lot of time. One thing, for example, that I deliberately don't like is being on WhatsApp groups, you know, like being on so many. I remember that is one thing that I had to, you know, kind of scale down. And I think I made a personal decision that I'm not going to be on any WhatsApp group, and I don't compromise on that. So if you put me on a WhatsApp group without my consent, I'll humbly request that. You know, yeah, please take me off, and I'll say I don't cope, but in case there is anything for which you need me, I'll be available, just reach me. So it's deliberate, you know, looking at this kind of issues around you and being able to create time for the things that matter. I have very many friends. I don't go out in the sense of going out, but I have very many people around me, and I think I am true to myself and the people around me. I have a number of girlfriends with whom we're in school over 30 years, and you know, they're still around my social support and circle, and a lot more. But at one point, I was like, okay, it's only going to be 2 years, people, and I may not be so much available, but when I really must be available, I'll be available. And after that, you know, business will go on. So you really have to be deliberate. And at home, it's also really planning for the home. Being a woman, being a wife, being a mother, there are responsibilities that, you know, you cannot delegate or you cannot go away from. So planning, for example, I plan for my home for a week. I do that on Saturday, yeah. Making sure that I need whatever I have, or I have whatever I need for the week. I do that on Saturday. So by the time the week starts, everything is sorted and cleared. I know how everything is going to run for the week. So I'm able to do that. So it may look obvious, but it kind of helps in terms of being organized and helping you and allowing you time to do everything else. Because now, given the schedules that I run, I cannot start planning on a daily basis, like today, what is going to be happening, tomorrow, what is going to be happening. You'll find like you don't be effective, and then you spend a lot of time dealing with those issues. And then when it comes to issues around parenting, I think, of course, there we support each other with my husband. And we know that we have to be available in the lives of the children. So we don't mind if we have to pick our children, pick and drop. I think that is okay. We'll create time for that because we know it's important. So we don't try to kind of find convenient ways around circumventing some of the responsibilities that we have to do. So even if it's 30 minutes or 1 hour or 2 hours that, you know, you spend, you know, with a child in a day, even if it's driving or they come to office, wait for you as you work, or at least you are there somehow in their lives, and you're able to also kind of watch, you know, as they grow up. So that is how pretty much we have managed.
I'm just curious, what time do you wake up?
I wake up, at one point I used to wake up at 4:30. I woke up at 4:30, but right now I wake up, and this is a recent decision again, I wake up at 5 sharp. So, and I'm out of my house between 5:30 and 5:40. And the reason I do that is I want to drive through seamlessly without traffic. So when I come in early, I can attend to some priorities that I have to attend to. I drop my daughter to school, or whoever of us leaves early, either me or my husband, whoever gets out first is the one who drops her to school. So we drop, and then we come to office and then settle to work.
What time are you up to?
out of office, it depends on what I have to accomplish. But I think most times I'm the first to come in, actually. First to come in the office, and among the last to leave, sometimes last to leave. So I leave any time between 6 and 9 p.m., so depending on what time I finish what I have to do, and sometimes if it's really, really a bit too much, maybe, okay, about 9:30. Beyond 9 is usually exceptional, but it's rare. So I'm able to accomplish whatever I have to do and be able to leave between 6 and 9 p.m. every day.
So I'm wondering, what does it feel like for you to be at the helm of this bank? What is the feeling like? Did you even ever imagine yourself in this position as you were perhaps going through your school life?
No, yeah. I never imagined. I never imagined myself in this position. It's not something that I really used to want so badly. But I think I just responded to the opportunity when it came through. I remember the way I joined. There was an opportunity to act as the CEO. It was the very first time I was even thinking of I can act in this role. But we were in a situation where there was probably no one else who could act in that position. So I think the board challenged me, not even challenged, but it was not directed, not challenged, but it was kind of a given that if I'm the most senior person currently in the organization, then I have to act in that position. So that's how I started, that's how I got into there, and that's how I started, you know, encountering what it looks like, learning actually what it is like. And of course, the board was really very supportive, given their experience as well. So that is how I kind of managed. So then there was an, of course, opportunity to fill the position substantively. And when I applied, I think because I had acted for more than 6 months, tried to do a few things right that were not done right, that should have given me an edge, and I matched the best in the interviews, and that's how I got the role substantively. So how I feel about it, it's an opportunity that came up, and then I took it up. And once I decided, and it was the situation that I am now there, I kind of had to take up the responsibility, take up the challenge, and begin to see how to do the best that I can do. I don't feel anything special. I don't feel that it's a special place to be in. I don't feel that it's something that I should really be very proud of. I don't know what right words to use, but I think it's an opportunity to do what I can to serve the country, because this is a national institution which has a lot of it has a key role to play in the development of the country. So it's I look at it as an opportunity to serve, and that's why we keep on trying to find the best way and best means in which we can deliver, you know, the services that we have to deliver to the public. Yeah.
Why are you not proud? Because not so many people get into that position. I think you should be happy that you're there. Don't you think so?
I'm okay.
Anyway, you do talk about the support that came from the board. Now, I was doing some reading around you and your work. And, well, I know the board supported you to get to certain positions, but I also know it got you into a bit of trouble at that point. That was around 2012, 2014.
Between 2012 and 2014, yeah.
Yes. So I think I saw somewhere you were being accused of a conflict of interest, where they said you actually perhaps influenced your appointment into the position of CEO. And then there was an incident of, harassing a whistleblower, perhaps who brought the case. And then you're also getting arrested. So I was just wondering, how did this impact on your work? Because you're here and you're working. So how did it impact on you, your career? How did you manage? Did you have to sit back? How did you go around it?
Wow, that story. Yeah, but of course at that point I didn't know about many things. I think I was coming from a purely professional, private background institution. And then when I got to UDB, I came in as a chief internal auditor. I think the department had just been restructured. And the board then hired a chief internal auditor, and then I came in, and I'd just finished my MBA, so I was like, let me see what opportunities are there outside Stanbic, because I had worked in Stanbic for 10 years in the position of senior audit manager. So I looked at it as an opportunity, career growth, and then the moment I came in, I must say I was a bit shocked. It's not what I expected. This was a purely typical government run like a pure public sector, you know, kind of institution. And by then I didn't have much experience, you know, with public sector. But then my understanding was just that I think if it's an institution, it's a body corporate, there is a way things just must be done. And I think what was done here was really not right at all across the board. So my role was for an internal auditor. So first I had to set up the department because it was not there. And then started to work based on my experience. So what I recall is that I started to work, all the reports that I used to do were unsatisfactory, as we used to call them. So all the reports. And the board appreciated what I was doing. And they were saying if you had come here even 2 years ago, this institution would have changed. And the board asked me to do an investigation into a portfolio. I think it was a trade finance portfolio, a product that they had introduced, but then that product was not managed well. All those loans had gone bad. So the board asked me to do an investigation. And when I did it and I gave the report implicated senior managers. I think the CEO then, the former CEO, and then one or two senior managers then. The bank was also going into a transition at that point because the old board was going out and then the new board had come in. So I did that audit. I gave the report to the board and then the board tried to handle it and then they left the old board. So now there was a new board that came. It was very many things happening that year. Even the auditors changed. So there used to be Ernst & Young, but that year also there's PwC. So PwC did the audit. They did not conclude the audit. I did not know because I was not in mainstream management. And so when the new board came and said, where's the audit report? PwC, who are the new auditors, said, we did the audit. We have finished, but we've not issued the opinion because we've disagreed with management on a number of issues. So anyway, fast forward, the bank's accounts, you know, had a disclaimer of opinion that year. And the base of disclaimer of opinion was the management had been implicated in an internal audit forensic report. And without a forensic investigation, the auditors say they cannot rely on representations of management. So now that's the opinion that the new board got. So they needed to start from somewhere, and that's where they had to start from. So when they started from there, they needed to understand what's going on, if there is an allusion of a forensic, you know, audit. And then Auditor General was invited to come in and do the forensic audit. And to pave way for that, the senior managers were suspended. After that, they eventually got terminated. So one thing led to another. Those guys got terminated, and then at that point, that's when now I was appointed to act as the CEO. So then that's the institution now that I found, with everything kind of wrong and messy. And those are the issues that later, I think, culminated into what you saw in terms of me being arrested, etc. So what happened is when the other group is out, and then now I am in, without anyone yet, no, not many people, because now you're still trying to understand what's going on here and then trying to put things right. I recall there was nothing like a strategic plan. There were, everything was really upside down, let me just put it that way. No policies or procedures or anything around risk management. And this is a bank, you know. So it was really a process with the board then of trying. Even the board at that point really had to come in to do a lot of work because that was the state of management. So in that process, there's also a lot of cleaning up in terms of now you're putting in place processes, you're putting in place policies. If anyone happens not to kind of, because you're trying to create a new culture. So if, for example, you find cultures that are not fitting in the institution that the board was trying to create, so a number of people found themselves, you know, kind of leaving at that point, okay? So while we're still trying to work, one day, IGG started coming in. Of course, we're accused. Now that is the accusation. So the accusation was around corruption. So suddenly, I am branded corrupt, myself and the board. So they had to find some criminal, find some kind of criminal charges or allegations and use those. So when I used to read the IGG letters then, it seemed that they wanted to create some criminal kind of charges. So, you know, when you have criminal charges and then the HR policy then said if a staff is criminally charged, they may be suspended. If the matter is not resolved within 3 months, they may be terminated. So I think the people who were behind this thought it would have been that easy. Like, just frame any, you know, criminal charges, the guys will be, you know, suspended. And then, of course, we cannot prosecute this. And then, you know, as time goes on, they will just be terminated. So that's what, you know, really, that was the plan. Yeah. Unfortunately, for them, if I can say that, the board put up a strong, you know, I don't want to say a fight or something, but I mean, there has to be fairness in this. Where is this coming from? What wrong have we done? We are only trying to do right things, okay? So they challenged the board. We challenged the actions of the IGG and asked for a judicial review first into the actions of the IGG, given the way the bank is set up, but also to review really what went wrong. So I think that was the first case of victimization of a whistleblower. So one person who had left in that process just went to present themselves to the IGG that they were terminated because they reported grand corruption that was happening in the bank. So it was framed. So that is the whistleblower issue.
Let's take a short break and we shall be returning with more questions for Ms. Patricia Ojangole, MD, Uganda Development Bank.